Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you enjoyed the music. It was the Killers, Human. I'm very pleased to be chairing this really significant event tonight. I think it's very important, as do all of you, as indeed do our panelists tonight. This is a really serious and topical and ongoing issue. So it gives me very great pleasure to be your chair and to have been invited by Bristows, who've presented the occasion, and their brochure is on your seat if you want to know more about them. But we have them to thank for this. Required notice, it says here. There are no planned fire alarms. Well, that's good. But if the alarm sounds, please evacuate the building by the nearest marked fire exit sign, exit through the main entrance, turn right, and assemble at the emergency point at the top of the Duke of York steps. Okay? Good. Now to the serious matter. We have four people on our platform who are extremely distinguished in their field, and indeed, I happen to know that many of you are also distinguished in this field, so you will know perhaps their work. You will certainly want to hear what they have to say. The four are Dr. Helen O'Neill, Dr. Nessa Casey, Professor Robin Lovell-Badge, and Dr. Roger Novak. The first person to address you is Dr. Helen O'Neill. Helen is lecturer in reproductive and molecular genetics at UCL and director in reproductive science at the Women's Health Institute program there. Her research focuses on pre-implantation embryo development and the use of CRISPR genome editing to assess understanding and disorders of infertility. Helen.
Thank you very much for the invitation to speak, both the Royal Society and Bristow's law firm. I once had an argument with my twin about our preferred choice of career path, and she did law, and she told me that more people would be interested in law and she would be paid more, and I'm glad to see that only one of those statements is still true. So I have been told to give a high-level factual description of genome editing technology, the mechanism of CRISPR-Cas9, current use in research, and potential therapeutic uses. Now, if I were to indulge myself, I would happily speak to you for the next 10 hours, but fortunately for you, and unfortunately for me, I have only got 10 minutes. So what I will do is endeavor to give you a highlight of what CRISPR is, what it is not, what it could be, what it can be used for, and I will leave it up to you for what it should be used for. So we have been attempting to make edits in genomes for approximately 50 years, or as long as we were able to uncover mechanisms to do so. The application of CRISPR-Cas9 has been in existence for 3.5 billion years. So while it is a new application, the components of CRISPR are far from new. It is not synthetic, it is not unnatural, it is innate and a natural bacterial immune system. Now, the CRISPR acronym goes a long way to describe what it actually is and does. It stands for clustered, regularly interspaced, short palindromic repeats. Stay with me. These clustered, regularly interspaced palindromic repeats were the visual of the genome of bacteria. And what it did was it highlighted to scientists over a long period of time that these intervening palindromic repeat sequences were not natural to the bacterial genome. What they served was as remnants for every fight a bacteria had had, and that bacteria had won that fight. In other words, what these sequences served as were remaining pieces of a virus that had tried to attack a genome. So a bacterial genome works in its immune system by cutting this piece of DNA and inserting it into its own, thereby rendering it immune from any future infections from a bacteria of the same source. So it's very clever when you can use the exact same mechanism to edit any genome. Now, this only took center stage in 2012 when Jennifer Doudna and Emmanuel Charpentier were able to harness this bacterial tool in the lab. And since then, almost every lab globally has uptaken its pipettes and adopted CRISPR for every biological organism there is. and it works well. The reason it has been taken so quickly and vastly spread is because of its ease of use, its adaptability, and its affordability. But I will say that its ease of use and its affordability must be put in context with its predecessors. It is not easy for anyone to use. Its predecessors, zinc finger nucleases and talens, have also been described as the best way to ruin a postdoc's career. They are time-consuming, expensive, and cumbersome to use. Since the acronym was coined in 2002, there are now 19 million hits on Google when you Google CRISPR. There have been 5,000 publications since 2012, and that's probably an underestimation. There are dozens of clinical trials, at least 28 patents. I think that's actually 28,000 patents. Dozens of patients have subscribed to these clinical trials, and two babies have been born to this technology that we know of. This is nothing short of a nucleotidal wave. Not only does it have the ability to tailor therapeutics, it has the ability to correct and enhance the current ways that which we can prevent cancer. So you can take an individual's immune cells who is suffering from cancer, and you can trick their immune cells or edit them to fight the cancer. This is chimeric antigen receptor therapy or CAR T cell therapy, and it is already being used on patients. It could be used to prevent illness in future patients. 8 million babies are born every year with a congenital defect. Many of these will die. In fact, there's a majority of those with severe genetic illnesses which will die very soon after their birth. It is the will of most parents to want a healthy child, free from illness. In the words of Isaac Newton, a fellow of the Royal Society, "I can calculate the motions of heavenly bodies, but I cannot predict the madness of men." The same can be used for the application of CRISPR. It has the potential to do great good, but the potentiality can be used against it as well. But rather than dwelling on the bad side, I think it's best that we focus on the good. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Helen. Our next speaker is Dr. Nessa Carey, visiting professor at Imperial College and author of Hacking the Code of Life, How Gene Editing Will Rewrite Our Futures. She's also written a book called Epigenetic Revolution and one called Junk DNA. She knows what she's doing. So she now specializes in moving basic research out of the lab and into places where it can impact on health, society, and the economy. And she's going to address the question, should we be able to modify our genome and the genome of future generations? Nessa.
Thank you. So it's a huge privilege to be here today talking to you. I'm trying to pretend I'm really cool about it, but I am insanely excited. I'm just in a right state. It's ridiculous. I think one of the things we'll pick up on first is one of the areas that Helen raised, which is about what we call somatic gene editing, where we can change the DNA of an individual to enable them to fight disease in one form or another. And this is essentially developing new drugs. And I worked in the drug discovery industry for quite some time. And many aspects of using CRISPR to treat disease in this way will go through very similar regulatory frameworks that we already have for developing new drugs, where we're essentially assessing the risks and the benefits, and is the playoff between the two good enough? So we'll start with safety trials, and then there will be trials to see if the CRISPR actually works, and there'll be post-marketing monitoring of the changes in the drugs. So in many ways, this is just business as usual. This is just how do we test drugs? But there is something about CRISPR that makes it very different from business as usual, and that is we can't withdraw the treatment once it's been given. When we have made the changes to a patient's genome, those changes are there, and they are permanent. The only way we could change them back would be going in and re-CRISPRing back to the original. And I think one of the implications of this is going to be that we will see quite prolonged post-marketing monitoring of CRISPR patients, and that this will then drive up the costs of clinical trials and will have an impact on whether or not these therapies are commercially viable for different conditions. I think because we'll also see that this has to move in a stepwise fashion because it's such a new technology, we'll see a very obvious gradation in the ways in which it is implemented. It will be implemented in very severe conditions early. It will be implemented in conditions where you can control delivery just to one organ, such as the eye, long before we see it on the whole being used very broadly. Because it is different from anything we've done before. Almost all drug discovery, one of the major things that you do is try to prevent any changes to the DNA of the patient. This technology, we're actually trying to change the DNA. So that does change the game. But the weird thing is that most drug discovery, the basic things that you use as the drug treatment are very expensive to produce. So very few people can decide that they will give themselves a new therapy or they'll try and create a new therapy and test it on themselves. But the basic reagents in CRISPR are actually really quite cheap. I know they're not cheap as chips, but they're pretty cheap, which means we are already seeing the phenomenon of biohackers, people working in their garage, deciding they're going to treat themselves, not necessarily for a condition, just to try and enhance themselves. And we could prohibit this. We could write laws against it. We have to remember that prohibition will not stop people doing it. If there is one thing that humans seem to believe is a divine right, it is their absolute right to do something phenomenally stupid. It is a right individuals will defend, sometimes literally to their dying breath. So we will not be able to stop people. And that raises an interesting question. If somebody does harm to themselves through stupidly using gene editing, and to be clear, I think the harm that would come from that would be probably from a lack of sterility in the reagents or contamination, not from the gene editing itself. Should we treat them? Should the NHS have to take on that burden? And I would argue it does, because we treat people whose health is influenced by cigarette smoking or alcoholism or falling off a mountain they decided to climb. We do not withdraw treatment from people because they were injured in the course of a criminal activity. So I think even though it's gene editing, we would still have to go ahead and treat. I think those are quite easy things to handle. Where the world of gene editing is creating real controversy is in the area of germline gene editing, where an embryo is edited very early stage in development, and every cell in that embryo will carry the edit, and they will pass on that change to their offspring. And there's a fabulous report from the Nuffield Council on Bioethics. Julian Hitchcock from Bristows was one of the authors of this, which lays out the ethical questions on this beautifully. And we need to keep it in proportion. The number of people who will have germline gene editing is probably quite small, but I would argue that doesn't minimize the need to consider the ethics of this situation. An ethical thing doesn't become right or wrong just because of the number of people involved. Ethics is independent of the numbers. And so we need to be thinking about this. Some people will say, really, is it an issue? And I heard a very interesting statement from somebody from a patient group where there's a devastating disease in a family who said, when we will ask you for gene editing for our embryos, all we will be asking you to do is change that person's DNA sequence to the same sequence as is found in the other 7 billion plus people on this planet, which I think puts it into context rather well. But there are issues. Who gives consent? The person who is being edited is only an embryo at the time they're being edited. They cannot give consent. And where do we draw the line? Do we say it's for life-threatening disorders or life-limiting disorders or life-changing disorders? Where is that line going to be? And I don't think that's a question that should ever be left to scientists. We are typically really badly trained in ethics, and I think a much wider constituency is really important. Because there is no denying that there is the potential for the technology that is available in gene editing, in CRISPR, to drift over into the kinds of debates that were used to move forward the eugenics movement. I'm not saying that this CRISPR and gene editing will lead to a huge eugenics outbreak, but it raises many of the same ethical questions of how we value human life. I think one of the differences, of course, is that what we expect is that gene editing of individual embryos, that will be driven by the family of the patient, the future patient, not actually imposed by society, but we have to be very careful because there are subtle ways of changing people's ability to give meaningful consent. It also takes us into the issue of medical versus social models of disability. Is deafness really a disability, or is it just a social condition where there are linguistic groups who have derived? And if we start using gene editing to drive down the levels of congenital deafness, are we actually starting to minimize linguistic groups, which comes very close to UN definitions of genocide? It's a very serious issue to consider. And I think something else we need to think about in terms of this medical use or social use, whichever way we want to phrase it, of CRISPR is, why do we give our genome such special status? If we can use this technology to decrease human suffering, why would we not do so? Almost everybody is happy with the concept of, say, polio vaccination campaigns. There are very few people who say, we shouldn't vaccinate against polio, we should just have better care for people who are paralyzed as a consequence of a viral infection. If we interfere with viral infections, why do we feel that somehow that would be okay, but changing the genome to stop somebody developing a brutal disease would not be all right? And I don't think these are the questions on which we can have one debate and then draw a line in the sand. Lines in the sand are always washed away by the tide eventually. But I think what we have to keep doing is having that discussion about where, at any particular time, in any particular circumstance, we are drawing the line at that moment. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Nasa. Plenty to think about, isn't there? The next speaker is Professor Robin Lovell-Badge, who's the Senior Group Leader and Head of the Lab of Stem Cell Biology and Development Genetic Laboratory at the Francis Crick Institute. Now, the major themes of his current work, I understand, include sex determination, development of the nervous system and the pituitary, and the biology of stem cells within the early embryo and the CNS and the pituitary, looking to its governance. Now, he's going to address the question of how should gene editing be regulated? Robin.
Well, thank you very much. And where should we start? So I was asked to address two questions. So what should we ban and should there be international regulation? I think both would be difficult to achieve. So I personally think, so there have been various calls for a moratorium on germline genome editing. We can talk about that. I think that is unworkable and it's a bit pointless, to be honest. And there's been talk about should there be international laws regulating this area. So we're going to go into that a little bit. It's a complex area, as you've already heard from the previous talk. You have different types of approach. So you have somatic genome editing to treat patients with a genetic disease or potentially to make them resistant to an infectious disease even. You could extend that back in time. So in theory, you could do somatic genome editing on an embryo in utero. Again, that embryo wouldn't have the ability to give consent, but still, you know, people are, you know, you can never ask an embryo for consent. You can never ask a young child, a baby or a young child for consent. We do things to them the whole time to try and make their life better. So I think that it's generally implicit that as long as you're doing good, it's okay. The question is, are we doing good? And if the techniques work as well as some of the headlines suggest, then fine. But they don't quite yet. And that's the big problem. So Helen didn't get her 10 hours to explain all the issues. They work really well. They can work very efficiently in the lab. They can be, you know, you get, in most cases, you get exactly what you want. But there are some problems. Sometimes you don't get the correct change on the target you're trying to make a change at, and sometimes you get off-target events which could have bad effects. So clearly, people need to be cautious when taking this technology forward into the clinic, whether it's so somatic or germline, as we've just heard. That's the same with any other new technology. You have to balance risk and benefit whether you choose to go ahead or not. At the moment, the risks are too great. So various organizations who've been looking at this in great detail have come out with consistent statements saying it is far too early to proceed with germline genome editing because we just we don't know or we can't control at the moment adequately all the risks. So a pause on that, not necessarily a moratorium, but just don't do it because it's just not safe. It's stupid to go ahead. So when He Zhangqiu in China goes ahead on his own, ignoring advice, that was a very silly thing to do, and he may not have compromised the two girls who've been born. Maybe they're going to be fine, but maybe they're not. Maybe if they have children, maybe their children will inherit something which is not particularly good for them. So he was way too premature in what he did. So should we ban all this? Well, no, of course not, because the promise is so good, the potential there is so great that we shouldn't ban it. We also have related technology that's already in existence, and at least in the UK, well-regulated, and that's pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, which can be used, so associated with the IVF, to select an embryo that's going to be free from disease. It's very similar processes. You're making the similar sorts of decisions. You're not changing what's pre-existing in terms of the DNA, but you're choosing which embryo you want to have. It's quite a similar sort of process. We have good regulation to cover that, at least here. Should there be international regulation? That's really difficult. There are no truly international laws governing anything. The closest we get is to people who sign, countries that have signed up to, say, the Declaration of Human Rights. Even not all countries have signed that. The chances of having international laws on anything are zero. So I'm currently on a WHO committee that's looking at this whole issue of governance. And we aren't going to come up probably with a proposal for a worldwide laws. It's not going to work. So what we're going to try and do is come up with a framework which covers, you know, risks, benefits, that hopefully has models of ways it can be regulated, which will be a combination of perhaps some hard laws, including fines for breaking those hard laws, but a lot of soft laws, where the communities, if you like, regulate themselves. So it becomes, you get ostracized by the rest of the scientific or clinical community if you go ahead with something too prematurely. So that's the way we're thinking at the moment. We haven't got there, but we've got another year or so to come up with a proposal. But the idea is to come up with a framework that then can, individual countries can then adopt into their own laws. And we feel that that's the most likely way we can do this. This framework has to encompass so many different things, though. It's not going to be simple. What about issues of social justice? So how do you have, it's okay for rich countries of the West, or some rich countries in Asia, to have somatic genome editing to deal with all of this. But then what do you do for countries that have very little money to spend on this type of approach? Currently, a single gene therapy treatment will market for about £500,000, for one patient. Really expensive. So if you really want to help people and benefit the majority of people, and there are many people suffering from genetic diseases in poor countries, if you think of things like sickle cell disease, as scientists have to come up with ways of doing this in a much less expensive way, but also society has to contribute ways of allowing the fantastic science to have the maximum benefit. So, no, I think we shouldn't ban anything. That gives them the wrong message. There's some exciting stuff here, but it needs to be approached cautiously and carefully. So I'll stop there.
Yes, exciting stuff, but moral dilemmas all the way. So, our fourth speaker is Dr. Roger Novak, who is the co-founder and president of CRISPR Therapeutics. He's an experienced biotechnology and pharmaceutical executive, and formerly was the professor of microbiology at the Vienna Biocenter in Austria. And he's going to address the question, what are the commercial prospects for gene editing and the implications of this for the pharma industry? Roger.
So I probably got the most boring part, yeah. So I will tell you first, before I do that, I'll tell you a little bit of a story, and then I try to get back to the commercial aspect, which obviously is an important one. And I just realized I think they're two twins, so I'm a twin as well. Identical?
Yes.
Same here. So my brother is not a lawyer, but he's doing something else anyway. What I like to do, and I have to apologize, I was aware of that I get a question. I knew the question. I was not aware of the fact that I should speak for 10 minutes. But I thought, while listening to my panel colleagues here, you know, what should I tell you? What could be interesting to you, you might not know yet. I like to start with that. And actually, I would like to start with how actually we got to CRISPR. So yes, there's a lot of history behind that, but how actually did it happen that some people thought about, you know, using CRISPR-Cas, which comes from bacteria, I'll come to that in a second, actually to translate that into human therapeutics. And not only human therapeutics, but also make use of that in any other field which actually in these days impacts society, namely, for example, agriculture and other aspects. So the story goes like that, and I'm not talking about patents and IP and who was first and who was last or whatever. That's probably not boring, but probably not in the interest of this audience. But I was in 2012, I was sitting in my office, and I got a call from Emmanuelle Charpentier. And she said, hey, how are you doing, blah, 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 this and that. And she said, what do you think about CRISPR? I said, what is she talking about, CRISPR? So I heard something about that, and she has a French accent. So I said, okay, can you repeat, you know? She said, yeah, CRISPR. You know, I said, I don't think anything about that, but you know, tell me what you think about that. So she went on and on and on and on, and then I said, you know, wait a minute, I need to go into a meeting, but you can send me some material. I knew about the paper, but anyway. So I got some material, was busy, and then shared that with a colleague of mine. I asked her before, who is a venture capitalist, or at the time was a venture capitalist. And he said, you know, I have a look at that. And a few weeks later, he came back and he said, hey, man, you need to leave your job. And I said, yeah, good idea. I love Paris. So I was working in Paris at the time. And so you have to have some really good reasons to do that. And so he walked me through that. It took about 9-12 months for me then to decide to leave my job. But then actually we really founded together with Emmanuel, Sean, myself, and his company CRISPR Therapeutics. That was end of 2013. We got a little bit of a financing, and it took us about one full year. We founded the company in Switzerland, one full year to come up with a strategy, what we really wanted to do with CRISPR-Cas. In the meantime, two other companies were founded, Intellia and Editas. They had other ideas what to do with that. And we decided, and now I think this becomes relevant for this audience, we decided to say, okay, listen, guys, this is a very new, immature technology. Why don't we overcomplicate it? Why don't we really try to reduce it to practice in the most simplistic way? And I think you heard that there are very different ways to use CRISPR-Cas. You can knock down things, so use a mechanism of non-homologous end joining. You can try to insert templates, DNA templates, or you can even regulate by using a dead Cas9. And so we said, okay, number one, we want to really make use of the system which is most suitable to CRISPR-Cas, and that's actually knocking down a gene. And then we said we want to do something which actually allows us to stay outside the body. It means we take cells from a patient, modify these cells with CRISPR-Cas, and then have the opportunity to really control this, make this a drug product, and give it back to the patient. So that was the idea by probably end of 2014. By then, we had about 100 million in the bank and five people in Switzerland, and actually were forced to do something. And that's another story. So we said, okay, we need to go to the US, to Boston, to really build something up. Now, fast forwarding, where we stand today is that the company CRISPR Therapeutics has three active clinical trials, two in hemoglobinopathies, sickle cell disease, and beta thal. We know, and this is in the public domain, that the beta thal patient, which was treated first in Germany in February, is off transfusions until now, so it's November. Data on the so-called fetal hemoglobin will be released within the next 10 to 14 days, probably at ASH. And we also expect at the same time first data on the sickle cell patient. So we're very optimistic. We also have a clinical trial running in the US where we use T-cell editing and actually use the allogeneic approach, so we move away from autologous therapies to allogeneic therapies simply because we can make use of multiplexing in CRISPR. That means that you can do multiple edits at the same time and in addition insert a template, in this case a functional domain called CAR. So long story short, CRISPR in the clinical arena, even controlled by Western European or North American regulators, is happening. I think one of the lessons we learned is there's a lot of stuff to learn. The first time we edited human hematopoietic stem cells, we had editing rates of 3 to 4%. Today, we have clinical batches, which actually we edit up to 80, 90% throughout. And so there's a lot of learning to be done. The other aspect I would like to mention, and when we talk about embryonic editing or germline editing, is we are even not in the position yet. We will be there. Our company has programs, other companies have programs, and they will, in my view, come to fruition, but it will take probably another 12 to 24 months before we see them in the clinics. These are programs where we use CRISPR-Cas, their components, and try to deliver them systemically so that they can target either a specific organ or, more importantly to us, obviously cells. We still don't control in detail the safety and in particular not the pharmacology. Pharmacology probably for germline editing is a slightly different question, but safety considerations are of utmost importance. The other thing I like to say is that we always talk about gene editing, and because of that word we think about genetic disease. We should keep in mind that in particular our company, but it's not only our company, we are not only using CRISPR for the treatment of genetic disease. That's one aspect, sickle cell disease, hemoglobinopathies, but we have major programs ongoing. You will see that next year in oncology. There are major programs ongoing in regenerative medicine where we use iPSC cells and so on and so forth. So it is also something we need to understand. We are not only talking about orphan genetic disease, we talk about diseases which will impact or do impact our society as such. And that, and now coming to the commercial question, is for sure a huge challenge with regard to society, with regard to payers. How do we reimburse? And the answer is relatively simple in my view. We need new models. And we have discussed this, and others are discussing this, for example, for gene therapy, we see that. We need new models where we have, for example, outcome-related payments. There are private-public partnerships in this kind of context. So there are new models to be implemented, in particular for diseases which affect large proportions of the society. For example, type 1 diabetes. We have a program in regenerative medicine in type 1 diabetes. For sure, these are very different numbers and significantly larger challenges for payers as if you go after a couple of thousand patients or less for a gene editing approach. Last but not least, when I got invited, I started to, so us as a company, we have a clear and have to have a clear position on germline editing. I speak here more or less as a private person as much as I can do that. So I allow myself to express some personal private views. But one thing I realized when I started to educate myself a little, bring myself back up to speed, what happens actually in the embryonic or germline editing field is, number one is, wow, lots of stuff is happening, in particular also with regard to stem cell research. But at the same time, I said, wow, guys, if you really want to use CRISPR in this kind of setting, you can learn from companies like CRISPR and others who work in the somatic area quite a lot, also with regard to safety. Just a comment on the side. We burn through, and I hope it's not just burning money, but we burn through each year by now to $200-250 million. We have about 300 people in R&D just doing CRISPR-Cas. So it's a huge amount of knowledge accumulated by now, which for sure we use in the somatic field, and I think we use it in a good way. But I have to say that when I listen to talks, when I listen to YouTube videos or whatever it is, whatever outlet is used, that there's a lot of, I would say, CRISPR-Cas knowledge which we could transfer if we wanted to this field. And with this, I stop.
Now it's your opportunity. Thank you very much to each of those the contributors for the panel. But we want to engage them, do we not, in what they have said, and to challenge them and to contribute to the debate. And there are many people in this audience who would like to join in. There are four microphones on the go somewhere. Can I see them? Yes. Good. Okay, so who's going to start? Who would like to open the bidding, as it were? Yes, somebody there. Could you please say your name clearly and what institution, if any, that you represent?
Okay, I'm Professor Hans Staus. I'm from UCL and I'm an immunologist. So we use gene-enhanced, gene-modified immune cells to treat cancer patients. And my question is actually a science-related question. So with gene-edited immune cells, we know that gene insertion can cause side effects and can cause actually unintended cancer in those patients. And I just wonder how much do we know there with a CRISPR technology? A specific question, when you said initially it was 3% efficiency and now 80% efficiency, is the range then of unintended integration and modification also enhanced with the enhanced efficiency? And how do we get to a situation where the side effects actually can be measurable and can be sort of calculated?
Roger?
I have the impression that's a question for me, you know? Yeah, good question. So I think a few points of clarification are important here. So most of the work, at least I can only speak about the work obviously done in our company. That kind of work is done in T cells. And the only thing we insert is very specifically a CAR domain into the TRAC locus. So that's something we are in the position to do this extremely well, and it's extremely well controlled. There is another issue though. So when I talk about multiplexing, and that's something which works for CRISPR-Cas extremely well. So I think it was rightly mentioned before, obviously gene editing has been around for quite some time, zinc fingers, talons, meganucleases, and so on and so forth. But one of the big advantages of CRISPR-Cas is also with regard to manufacturing over time, is that you can do multiple edits in one go, so to speak. There is a challenge for sure with that, because when you have multiple edits, you run the risk that you have potentially translocations or larger deletions, which you for sure have to control. So if you edit your T cells, you know, in this kind of way, you have to have methodologies in place which monitor this. So the way I would put this, we are in a clinical trial in the US right now with T cells where we have two edits, beta 2M, so to avoid host versus graft reaction, and TCR to avoid graft versus host reaction, and then a CAR and a TRAC locus. So we don't see significant evidence here for translocation, and with that potential, I think in T cells we anyway don't have too much that kind of risk. However, and that's the future for sure, if you want to go into solid tumors, you probably need to edit significantly more loci in the T cells. And with that, the more loci you edit, the more you run the risk that you see some translocation. And obviously, you give more than just one cell back to the patient. Having said this, this is top priority for us, for the principal investigators, and for sure for the regulators, to make sure you reduce that risk to a level which is acceptable to your patient.
Happy with that? You don't want to engage. Right, the next question. Someone here? The microphone, please.
Hi, thanks very much. My name's Alexander Phillips. I'm part of the London Biohack Space, which is a community-run lab. It was actually the first in the UK to get CL1 certified. So I'm interested in why it was CRISPR-Cas9 and not RAV. I don't know if you're familiar with RAV. It's recombinant, let's see if I can get this right, recombinant adenovirus-associated, it's used by Horizon Discovery, which I'm sure you're familiar with. Mm-hmm. Why was that not the technology that is now being talked about? Have you got any comment on that?
Robin?
The adeno-associated virus, adenovirus, as vectors for somatic gene therapy have been around for quite a number of years, and they have been very useful in some contexts. But of course, you know, these are very difficult things to do in a garage, in a typical place where maybe a biohacker would be working, because they're much harder to grow up. They have to be pure. You have to know that they are safe to use. The CRISPR-Cas9 is, in a way, it's simpler. You don't have to, depending how you, it's still how you're going to get it into your cells is the problem. So if you're Josiah Zeno, who's going to simply try and inject it into his arm muscle, that's silly, it's not going to work. He's going to cause himself probably more damage from doing that than helping anything. You might still have to use an adeno-associated virus or other viral vector to get them into your tissues efficiently enough. And again, I'm afraid that's going to be, I think, difficult for a typical garage science person to do in a way that's safe.
Yeah, a very brief comment on that. Absolutely. I say we have major programs using AAV, for example. Whenever you have a template, and whenever you want to bring CRISPR-Cas into a specific cell, you need to have some kind of delivery moiety. This can be an LNP. In many cases, it's a vector with so-called tissue tropism. Boy, that's an art. I mean, that's tough. I mean, it's really hard. And I mentioned a number before that we spend about 200 plus million. That has to do with cell therapy in particular. I don't know the exact numbers we and others spend right now on programs like that. For example, to go after Duchenne's muscular dystrophy, we have a major program with Vertex now. You can try to do this in a garage, but to be very honest, I think you will not succeed. It is super tough, not because of the technology as such, but there's so many considerations to be given. Mm-hmm. So it's tough. It's not easy. Yeah.
Helen, would you like to make a comment?
I would say watch this space when it comes to recombinant adeno-associated viruses, because I think moving forward, it won't be gene therapy as has traditionally used these viruses or gene editing, but the combination of the two that will really progress both fields. Gene therapy has traditionally adopted the use of these viruses for over 30 years, and I think this timeline in its trajectory speaks a lot about the difficulty with using these viruses. But I think moving forward, I think the application of the two or the combination of the two will really propel things forward.
Nessa?
No, I think I agree with everything. I mean, and actually this has been a problem in all sorts of drug discovery. Is even if you look at small molecule drugs, it's often very easy to create something that in a test tube will inhibit a particular enzyme or a receptor. The difficulty is always getting it into the human body at the right levels to the right tissues. And that's relatively easy for small molecules, and it still kills a large number of programs. Trying to do it with complex gene editing technology, it's just a different level of magnitude. So it's the postman rather than the letter that's the tricky bit in this.
The next question. There are two people sitting down. Let's take both of the questions, shall we? Can you bring the microphone round to the middle?
Hi, Hello, my name's Hilary Sutcliffe. I run a not-for-profit in the UK called Society Inside, which is about people and planet at the heart of innovation. I was also, until recently, the co-chair of the World Economic Forum Values, Ethics and Innovation Council. I'm running a project on trust in the governance of technology. So not trust in the tech, but trust in the governance. And looking at, you know, these techs just, you know, God, we don't even know what to think. But we want to be able to trust the governance. So I wondered if I could ask you, as part of this project, this is a sort of consultation moment, do you have any views on what could have society able to trust the governance of these technologies, not just the technologies themselves, and obviously aware of what you're doing, Robin, as well?
Okay, hold that question in your mind, and then the other person behind you. We might kill two birds with one stone, yes.
Okay. Hi, my name is Dr. Crystal Ruff, and I'm here as a trustee for Genetic Disorders UK. My question is about the future of healthcare with gene editing and gene therapies and whatnot. So with PGD, PGS, we are effectively getting rid of certain genetic diseases from the family tree forever. Also with gene editing, we can work at a smaller level. What's that going to do to the healthcare system? Effectively, that means we could eradicate rare disease in, what, 2-3 generations. What's that going to look like in terms of society and the healthcare system?
Well, they're big questions, aren't they? Trust and the future of society, that's all.
Okay.
Who's going to have a go?
I can, Robin, have a quick go to start with, maybe both of them very quickly, but... of course, if you really want the public to trust the way you've come up with a way of governing something, then you should involve them from the beginning in it, so you have appropriate engagement with the public to get their views all the way along, get their views on how it should best be done. Then, obviously, they're more likely to trust what you come up with in the end. And that's the WHO committee is supposed to be looking worldwide at governance, and of course, we can't engage everyone in the world, but what we can try and do is at least... think about what are the best ways of doing public engagement in this area, and then suggesting that various countries have a program of public engagement where they use these best methods, hopefully.
Can I just intercede here? Because while you talk about we need to think of ways, well, while all this thinking is going on, what is Roger up to?
Well, we hope Roger's well behaved. I mean, we can't. Can we trust you? No, you're not. There are regulatory mechanisms in place for somatic genome editing in countries like the UK, most of Europe, the US, Japan, etc.
Effective?
I think it's adequate. Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, adequate. There are, however, many countries where there's little or no regulation, and the biggest fear that many of us have is that you are going to start seeing what's happened in, say, the stem cell field, where there are all these rogue clinics offering direct-to-consumer stem cell treatments, which are not treatments. They are probably dangerous and may end up doing more harm than good. Either they have no effect or they're doing harm. And these, of course, are being offered simply as a way of whoever's running the clinic to make lots of money from desperate patients. And you can imagine the same thing happening in the genome editing field. In fact, there are already some clinics out there who are advertising to do this. So I think all we can do at the moment is just say, you know, point out to... regulators or the governments in various countries, keep an eye on this. Please do whatever you can, whatever mechanism you can use at the moment to curtail this activity, because it's going to be very damaging, damaging potentially to the patients and damaging to the whole enterprise, where what we're trying to do with this science is do good, and we do not want it spoiled by people doing stupid things.
Yes.
Yeah. Maybe a con. I was thinking about this because we are here in London, and probably hear that I'm German. Germans treat So I think what we need to keep in mind that they're different cultures. Say, for example, genome editing is probably very differently debated in Germany compared to the US. Yeah? So we have, in Germany so far at least, you know, people were very, very skeptical. And I think the engagement, which is happening right now, by the way, in Germany, with the public, you know, has to happen in a very responsible way. And I think that addresses maybe the second, or comment on the second question. I think all of us, be it industry, be it academics, we have a responsibility to manage expectations. I personally do not believe that in 2-3 generations, we are in the position to cure every genetic disease. I think that's just not true. And even if you didn't mean that, I know what kind of point you wanted to make. Yeah. So, but to be fair, you know, I think number one is trust. How do you go about trust? I think official companies you can probably trust because we have governance in place, and if we don't stick to that, you know, we are toast. Yeah. I think we need to make absolutely sure that in countries which have less regulations, that academics, like in China, for example, in China, CRISPR-Cas is used in the clinics in oncology. We know that for a fact. Many, many trials are running. People are treated. We don't know anything about it. Yeah, so that is an issue. So how do you build trust, and how do you, in the end, bring the Chinese to the table to discuss these kind of issues, because these are issues. And the other thing is, I said this before, I think when you think about education, and then now going back to Germany for a second, for me personally, having left that country in 1996, so it's quite some time, it's the first time that I realized that people are really interested. So that's something, you know. I'm pretty amazed to see so many people here. It's obvious that people are interested all of a sudden about something which is called CRISPR-Cas. And I think that's a responsibility, that's an opportunity we all have, but it also is a risk. And I think, as I said before, all of us who are the so-called experts need to make sure that we stay professional, manage expectations, and actually employ a governance which we can stand behind. You know, that I personally think is super important.
That's where you would like to be.
Yeah, I think it's also really important to remember that for biological reasons, we will not wipe out genetic diseases by germline gene editing. And that's because we may do that in a particular family, but so many genetic conditions are recessive. So the first time that you know that there is a condition in a family is because an affected child is born. The parents were both carriers. And also even in the dominant disorder, where you only need one mutated copy of the gene, a substantial number of those arise through new mutations. So again, the first you will know that this condition has arisen is when a child is born with that. That may impact on the reproductive choices of the family subsequently, but we will not wipe out genetic conditions because of that simple biology.
And you're nodding in agreement, Helen.
Well, in answer to the second question, I think it is very critical to correct your terminology where you refer to pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, or PGD, and pre-implantation genetic screening, or PGS. And you have said that using these, or the adoption of these, can prevent future illnesses or eradicates them, and that's simply not the case. In fact, PGS and PGD for certain has been around for 30 years, and we are nowhere near eradicating any genetic diseases. Unfortunately, as Nessa has pointed out, it has to, the first indication that you will have usually in a family line that you have a genetic illness is by a genetically related an affected child. So subsequent children would have to undergo PGD, which would select the embryo that does not carry the mutation. Germline genome editing would do much along the similar lines, only it would correct the mutation in an affected embryo. Therefore, you are not eradicating it from the future germline of those parents. The parents for any subsequent children would still have to undergo germline genome editing, then pre-implantation genetic diagnosis to diagnose that embryo for any future offspring. It may eradicate it from that germline, but it does not come close to eradication of genetic diseases, as most mutations, or very many mutations, are de novo. Is that not a good thing?
I don't think so.
Yeah, is it, why would that be a bad thing?
Great.
Can I just move on? There are two people I think might be in the audience. I'll come in a minute to you, but there are two people who might make an interesting contribution at this point. Is Françoise Baylis here? Is she here? Yes. Would you care to comment on what has been said? Françoise is the author of a book called Altered Inheritance, which makes what you have to say relevant.
So I guess my comment would be I was quite impressed by your question to the effect of, well, what do we do in the meantime in terms of issues of governance as we're busy trying to sort things out? And I think one of the things that's very interesting is I do believe most people are on board with the idea that it's very important to involve the public early on. And a lot of my work right now is around the idea of not focusing on that from what we refer to as a knowledge deficit model. Oh, the public doesn't understand. If only they understood, they would agree with us. and I think that that's the wrong way to be thinking about the engagement. And so I think I encourage people to think about engagement as empowerment. And empowerment really means to provide people with tools. And some of those tools are not just about understanding the science, but understanding the values that are at stake so that one can contribute meaningfully to the conversation. So if I just pick up this last thread, you know, there's a question about, well, wouldn't it be great we would eradicate disease? And then the response from the panel is, yeah, that's a wonderful thing, right? And I think part of the question is, well, are we all in agreement about what constitutes disease, which was a comment made earlier, and there are different people with different perspectives. So is autism something that should be eradicated? Is congenital deafness something that should be eradicated? And so when I think of public engagement, it's about empowering people to be able to engage with that discussion.
But how do you make their empowerment effective?
I think where I come from, so I'm a philosopher for those of you who might be interested, I really believe that power comes with knowledge. And so I think a major part of what needs to happen is not just to think about explaining science, but helping people to connect up their core values with the science so that they can understand if these are the goals and objectives I have, and maybe some of those have to do with things like social justice, making this a better place, how can you imagine the science contributing to that goal or threatening that goal? And so what I think is really important is to help people understand the bigger picture. What kind of world are you trying to make? How might this science contribute to that world? How might it represent a threat to that world?
Thank you. And the person just in front of you would like to ask a question. Yes, you.
So I'm David King. I'm director of a small pressure group based in London called Human Genetics Alert. First, a brief comment, which is this was billed as a debate, and I would have thought in a debate you'd actually ask some real critics and opponents, but I guess at the Royal Society with a bunch of...
It's you. That's why you're here.
Yes, but you didn't give me or Françoise or... you know, any of the many other people that are out there, an opportunity to really say, no, this is a bad idea. So you asked for a challenge, and I'm going to try and do that work for you. So I guess it's in the form of a question, which is, given that there is no medical benefit of doing this in the germline, because we already have the tools, you're looking puzzled, aren't you? You've never heard that. There is no medical benefit because we already have the tools, as the lady behind me said, to prevent the birth of children with genetic diseases. Given that there is no medical benefit, how can people justify to someone like me? I'm a member of at least two groups who are targeted by eugenics. I'm disabled and I'm Jewish. How can you even begin to think about putting this on the table to put a technology like this, which will, you know, can radically, you know, exacerbate existing eugenics. And by the way, eugenics never went away. I can give you a dozen examples of it operating in the world right now. How can you begin to, you know, in this time of massive social inequality, rising right-wing authoritarianism? To me, you know, the very idea is really it's a weapon of mass social destruction.
Okay. And
I,
That's fine. Well, we take that point. You made it very forcefully. While the panel get their wind back, I want to ask if Dame Kay Davis is here, because she may have an answer for you. Is she here? Yes. Would you care to take up the debate? Professor Davis is the co-chair of the International Commission on the Clinical Use of the Human Genome, so she's right in the middle of this debate.
Yes, we're just about to have another public consultation, actually, on Thursday this week, so for those of you that want more of this, please come for even more debate on the Thursday. But you are addressing germline therapy, and I think that's one of the things that the Commission is going to look at very carefully. Is there really a clinical need right now that would justify any risks that there might be? Or have we even got the right social context to carry out human germline therapy? I think somatic cell therapy, of course, is quite different because it's equivalent to a drug treatment, as has already been said by our eloquent speakers earlier on. I also think we need to involve society, but we need to involve more patient groups too. And I think the more they are coordinated, I think the better we will hear them. And I think that's already been raised. And indeed, part of the International Advisory Commission is doing exactly that on Thursday, if you want to come along for that. Well,
one of the issues that was raised was balancing risk and benefit. So is that sort of cost-benefit analysis going forward? How do we do that in a science where the risks are so extraordinary and unpredictable?
Indeed. In fact, that's one of the things that the Commission has been tasked to do, to look at the science, to see where we are, what's the state of the art now, therefore, can we come out with a pathway where germline editing, in particular, would be safe and therefore potentially worth considering? I can't give you the answer to that because we haven't finished our deliberations, but we're looking at that extremely carefully.
Jo, may I make a point on this one?
Yes,
to address the questioner's concern. when I was an academic at Imperial College, one of the cases we used to discuss with students in genetics was a true case from a family who had been involved in the genetic counselling service. In this family, Huntington's disease ran in the family. Huntington's disease, as many of you know, if you carry the mutation, it is invariably lethal following a period of about 10 years of agonizing dementia. There was a woman, she and her husband wanted to have children, and one of them carried the Huntington's condition. She had prenatal testing. She had 10 affected embryos. She had terminations 10 times before she had an unaffected child. When we know that a condition runs in a family, even with, if we can do pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, it's quite feasible, because there's only a small number of embryos, that they will all carry the mutation. Now, if we can create a technology which is safe enough, I think then you have to flip the ethical question. I think you have to flip it from, do we have the right to intervene, to what right do we have to withhold this from a family who really are desperate for it.
Can I follow up on this? So, I mean, Huntington's is one case in point, and there are, in fact, of course, individuals, some relatively few, but there are some individuals who are homozygous for, yes, Huntington's mutation. They can't have a child who is not going to get Huntington's. The only way they could have their own genetic rated child is after genome editing to correct the defect. And then we all hope that somatic genome editing is going to be incredibly good and successful and allow a lot of individuals to now survive childhood and become teenagers and adults. And then they want to kind of have children, but actually their germline hasn't been corrected. So you've created in 20 years individuals who can't have their own genetic corrected children, maybe without, unless they have germline genome editing. Yes.
Roger,
do you want to
add anything?
I think it's a. I have to admit, I never thought about that one, but I think it's a good point. But I think in general, to ask the question if this is also from an ethical perspective at all something we want to do or not do, for sure, is a totally justified question.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I think also flipping it around, like Nessa, you said, it's also because we also need to understand, better understand, in my view, and we see this in parts. of the patients. So we have the patients in the company, and we start to understand what they're suffering from. And these are very individual, I would say, concerns they have, which are related to their disease, to their offspring, and so on and so forth. And I think sometimes very difficult, if you're privileged enough to be healthy, to fully understand what's happening there. Yeah.
Fine, the next question over here. Can you, the microphone's here, can you pass the microphone back to the gentleman there? I'm not neglecting people at the back. Yes.
I'm Peter Brody. I used to run the biggest pre-implantation genetic diagnosis unit in this country at Guy's Hospital. And I'd like to correct two things. Firstly, there seems to be a pervasive idea that society wants to get rid of people who are abnormal. It isn't society who used to come and see us. It was individual patients, often with an affected child, who would say, we don't want another child to suffer like that one. This is not a eugenic idea which society is putting out. It is patients coming and saying, please, can you help us? I think that's the first thing. The second thing is to address Nessa's point. She is well aware genetics has no memory. That woman could equally well have had the 11th child was entirely normal. And we have plenty of patients who came along with Huntington's disease who we could help to have babies that were unaffected. Even in that kind of case, which because you roll the dice, but there is a proportion. She was particularly unlucky. Yes. But the gene editing would still suffer from all the problems that PGD suffers from, because you would still have to biopsy an embryo to know that your gene editing worked. You would have to take account of mosaicism. You would have to take account of off-target effects. So the net effect is you have very little improvement on it. Perhaps you would have a few more embryos that were normal. But it doesn't solve all the problems that is being pushed out today.
To respond to that, can I just take it up? You speak about the individual, the answers we're given because of individual patients, right? But what is the consequence, as someone asked, about society later on? If all your patients were fortunate enough to have the remedies brought to them, what happens further down the generation? I mean, I know that there's a feeling among the deaf community, whom I know, that the deaf very often want to have deaf children. Indeed, the deaf community is a very positive social entity. Would you seek to eliminate that?
That is indeed a societal decision. In this country, we don't allow PGD to be done for that. There are very clear indications under which you may do it. You could probably, and one of the big problems that we face is the idea of international trade in the idea of PGD and in genome editing. So you're not going to eliminate it, but each society has to make its decision, and that is, in some regards, a eugenic decision that society is making. But in terms of what goes down the generations, there's something else to say, and that is, if there is a fear that germline genome editing may cause a problem in the next generation, remember, we are sitting here 20, 30 years on from when PGD is starting, and we've got a completely new way of looking at things. I guarantee you, by the time those children are even adolescents, there will be other ways of dealing with genetic disease.
Thank you. Another question, somebody over in this, further back there, I'm not giving scope to anyone at the back who wants to speak. There's somebody down here. I don't want to overlook you simply because you're at the back of the hall. Oh, there's somebody, oh yes, lots of hands over there.
Thank you. I'm Jane Spink from Genetic Alliance UK, and it's been fascinating listening to the debate today because it takes me back 20 years to the early days of gene therapy. And I've yet to hear any question asked in the context of genome editing that we haven't already examined in the context of gene therapy, including in relation to the severity of the condition you're intending to treat, and questions about risks and benefits, and questions determining whether the current informal moratorium on germline gene therapy should be upheld. So I suppose my question is there anything materially different? This is just a technology to achieve the same ends in the same context. Is there anything materially different about genome editing that would shift our opinion in terms of how we regulate this type of research?
Right. Nessa, you're the historian of the movement.
Oh, God. I was happily looking at other panel members.
Well, Benita will have to say.
I think the game changer with gene editing is simply to do with the fact the technology is potentially more powerful than gene therapy. It has fewer of the roadblocks. It still has a lot of roadblocks, but it potentially has fewer of them. But I think many of the ethical debates remain absolutely unchanged. I don't see a major difference in there. But I do think this is, in terms particularly of somatic gene editing, we are going to get successfully to clinical outcomes much faster than we did with gene therapy, which has gone through so many iterations of the Gartner hype cycle of peak of inflated expectations, trough of despond. What's a trough? I've no idea. I believe it's just going to get there a lot faster.
Well, I agree. I mean, the advantage of genome editing is simply that it can be far more precise. So with traditional gene therapy, you're putting in a whole gene to try and compensate for the absence of that gene product. And that gene could be integrated anywhere. It may not be regulated very well. If you can use genome editing to precisely correct the gene that's carrying the deleterious variant, that could be even just a single base pair change. Then you're going to get something that's going to work well, hopefully always, because it's going to be correctly regulated. Just to say that the technology we now have with genome editing, it's not a simple technique anymore. There are a whole variety of different methods you can use to, say, make mutations in genes, to replace whole large segments of genes and genomes, to go all the way down to making just single base pair changes. So there are relatively new techniques of base editing, and even much newer ones, just a couple of weeks old, called prime editing, which are very exciting because of the precision in which they should work and to give you precise changes. Now, we don't know enough about the last technique in particular because it's just new, what the disadvantages are of it. There probably are, but we don't know them yet. But we need to look at things like that in great detail. Roger?
Another question from the back.
Sorry,
Roger, do you want
to... Yeah, just a comment. I think we always hear this with regard to gene therapy, and I think... for sure, any new technology has their own risk. We don't understand everything, but I think just from the genetics, if you're a molecular biologist, if you're genetically educated, then you would understand, or you will understand, why the advantage is using gene editing. And so I think, obviously, always proof is in the pudding, but we already see that the advancement and the gain of knowledge in this field is so much faster than what we have seen in gene therapy. I think that's very impressive. Having said this, we ought to learn a lot from gene therapy, and there will be always room for gene therapy. Gene editing will not replace gene therapy.
Well, there are more questions at the back. There's one here. Can we have the microphone to the centre there?
Thank you. David Jones, I run a small bioethics centre, which is Roman Catholic. So my question is about international regulation and governance. I'm very much of the view that Britain is a corrupting influence in this area, and Francis Galton was, after all, British. My concern is in relation to Robin said, I don't want to ban anything, and perhaps that was a I think that in terms of what we release into the international environment, mm-hmm. that some selective bans might actually be, even though, as we see in weapons and as we see in other areas, sure. though they all have problems, they're much, at least they have a sort of clarity about them, whereas aspirations for good governance in countries may work well in a well-regulated sort of democracy as we have here, but increasingly less so in other countries. So in terms of thinking about the use of some selective bans, one should think of what actually could work internationally, not just what could work here, and and think also of the history of our influence on eugenics, which was that we produced ideas which didn't have such a bad influence in this country, but did in several other countries. And I'm thinking of America and Scandinavia, not just Germany.
Sure.
Can I just ask you, you said, as by way of introducing yourself, you did refer to Roman Catholic Church.
Yes.
What point of view does that church take?
So, in favour, in principle, of gene editing somatically, as with gene therapy, somatically opposed to germline genetic engineering. But I think a lot of it is actually about safety. The main concerns of, from a specific doctrinal point of view are to do with the embryo. So they actually have, there are a lot of people who are Catholic theologians who think about these things who are more concerned about PGD or abortion for reason of disability than they are about germline. If germline could be done, for example, through influencing the gamete-producing tissues. I don't take that view myself as an individual. I think I'm closer to David King on this in this regard. I am concerned per se about genetic germline engineering, but the church doesn't actually have a very clear view about germline per se. Its concerns are more about what its effect on society, what its effect on particularly on the early human life.
They don't think of it as an outrage to creation.
Well, no.
Okay. Does anybody?
No, as not with me. I mean, there are many, many Catholic hospitals.
I'm sure somebody does. Yeah. Right. This is a scientific community here. Can we have another question, please?
Yes. My name is Sarah Norcross, and I'm the director of the charity Progress Educational Trust, and we've done quite a bit of public engagement around human genome editing. And so my question is, do the panel think that genome editing is leading us on a quest for the perfect human? And if so, what is perfection? And if you think we should stop it, how do we stop it?
Well, it is the title of the whole seminar. So are we in search of the perfect human?
I don't think
what is perfect?
No. There's no such thing as the perfect human. We are very much erroneous in our making, in our being, and I think that needs to be taken into context when we think about the technology and its applications. We could perfect the technology, it could have zero off-target effects, but we would still be working with the most flawed biological medium, and that is human reproduction or human biology. It is innate in its very essence that DNA will break and it will repair in a flawed sense. We are destined for disease. We are destined to grow old. If we did not have disease and our tissues did not senesce, we would not die. So even if we perfected this technology and it became the go-to tool, we would still not be eradicating disease, and we would certainly not create the perfect human.
Yep. Right. Nessa?
The very idea that there is a perfect human, I think, is... It's biologically irrelevant and it's ethically disastrous, because the definition of the perfect human is always the definition based on the most powerful group in society at the time. So both biologically and sociologically, I would object to the concept we could or should aim for any such thing.
Nonetheless, the eugenics movement at the beginning of this century was perfectly possible and respectable. It was supported by people like H.G. Wells, George Bernard Shaw, Virginia Woolf. They all thought it was a good way of improving the human race. What do you think of that?
I think it was a flawed thinking, actually, really. But in this context, if we go back to genome editing, I think genome editing actually is anti-eugenic in a way, because it gives people more choice. So the idea of eugenics often is propagated, the way I've tended to think about it, is more state control over who gets to reproduce. If you can allow people to have their own genetically related children without them carrying a disease, that's giving them more choice. It's not reducing their choice.
Roger?
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. First of all, I would ask the same question: what is a perfect human being? I think already that definition is very difficult to make, if at all. And then the other thing, I think human biology, and we said this already, is so complex, we won't ever get there. Even if we would agree on the perfect human being, which we couldn't, because it would be gross. I think we should keep that in mind. That's actually a point I wanted to make at the very beginning with regard to managing expectations. What can you do with a technology like this? And I agree with you, by the way, that you know, it gives you more options. But when we look at these huge genetic data, the GOAS studies, so genome-wide association studies, for example, to identify new targets to better understand disease, I can tell you it's a mess. I mean, yes, we understand so much more. We understand so much more that this one pill fits all, you know, model doesn't work because of genetics. But how would you edit something like this? It makes no sense. I think what we're talking about here, at least from my perspective primarily, is disease, specific disease, in parts monogenetic disease, autoimmune disease, and oncology. Everything else, well, there are a few other aspects for sure. Everything else, you know, for me right now at this stage, well, it's something where we need to be aware that this will take a long, long time before we master anything like this, if we ever will.
Can I just add to that as well? I think we have to be very careful as a panel not to fall into a trap, which is that we've all almost accepted the premise of the question, or the premise behind the question, which is that our genome defines us, and it doesn't. Our genome is a starting point. It is influenced by vast numbers of other things, some of which are directed in terms of the environment, and some of which is just random stuff that happens. Our genome is our starting point. It's our starting material. But you cannot talk about a perfect human, or in the sense that you cannot talk about the perfect genome. Our genome is just our beginning. It is not who we are.
The identical version of my genome became a lawyer.
Exactly.
Yeah. I can say the identical version of my genome was very different.
Can I put another angle to the point that you raised, though, about its effect on society? Is there a risk here that those who benefit and eliminate the inheritable diseases are going to be seen to be of a cohort of the beneficiaries, social discrimination, that they will have benefited and plenty of people won't. So you'll get a hierarchy of worth, which is the sort of thing that our philosopher there was raising. We will get a hierarchy of worth from families and communities where people have improved their gene line and societies that have not been able to. That's going to be a problem,
Well, 40 years ago, the first IVF baby was born. Now 8 million babies have been born to the same technology. And the first question you ask somebody is not, did your parents have sex to have you? Quite the opposite. We don't know at all about these people. And it's not a mask that people would wear. It is just, we hope, a healthier livelihood, and that they would live long enough to actually procreate. But I certainly don't think that this is going to create a hierarchy.
Anyone else comment on that? You don't think so? I was just thinking about how well they would get, how much gene therapy they might get in Sudan, for example, or countries.
We have massive health inequality through all sorts of reasons. I think health inequality through genome editing is the least of our worries in terms of global health and access to global health.
Perhaps the International Commission can deliver that, among other subjects. Final questions then. Yes, somebody there?
Thank you. Rumia Nayotova, I'm a lecturer in international law at the University of Cambridge. I had a question about the work of the WHO panel. Is your approach focusing only on developing a framework for genome editing, or would it be a broader framework for genetic interventions? And the reason I'm asking that is thinking about the history of the rise and fall of all these genetic technologies. Would it not make more sense from a regulatory perspective to regulate the objective rather than the specific method? You already mentioned prime editing, and God knows what's going to happen in the future. So that's my question. And my comment is that I was going to disagree with you on the point about international law having nothing to say about genome editing, but I think we can have that conversation later over coffee. Thank you.
Robin.
Well, what can I say? Yes, I mean, I think whatever we come up with has to be a framework that can be very flexible and adaptable for whatever technology comes along. So, yes, so the whole idea is not to say we are going to restrict our framework to non-homology end joining or prime editing. It's got to cover broadly making changes to the genomes of individuals or embryos who've yet to become individuals, if you like.
Look, I'll fit one more question in here because there's a very eager hand over here. Microphone, please.
Hi, my name's Sonia O'Hara. I am a trustee of the Haemophilia Society UK and I am a real-world evidence consultant in HCD economics. We measure global burden of illness amongst a lot of illnesses and diseases. One thing I'm really encouraged to hear is how many people have mentioned patient input that's needed. We talk about society as a whole and the reflections of what we perceive society want. As I say, it's very encouraging for me as an advocate and also someone that sees the impact of Huntington's disease, sickle cell, DMD, all these things, lysosomal storage disorders, to get the patient advocacy at the table, to get the patient input from a regulatory governance framework perspective, for me, at the beginning of what I feel is going to be a huge, you know, impressive, exciting journey, is imperative. It's like trying to bake a cake without flour. We have to have that there as an ingredient. Otherwise, it's just not going to taste as sweet. Maybe I should have said sugar. But yeah, so it was very encouraging. So I thank you all that have offered that. That yeah. Personally to me means a great deal. But also looking at it from a commercial perspective, a lot of my clients are pharmaceuticals. It's things that I know they're going to have to consider and face and those types of things. So thank you very much for everyone who's contributed towards that. That was great.
Do you agree with what you said about the...
Absolutely. I think the patients' yeah. voices are the loudest it's voices.
Sense, yeah. Absolutely. No,
they are the ones with experience, they are the ones with affected family members, and they are the ones who have mm-hmm. felt the pain threshold of life-limiting disorders.
Mm. Well, it is time to end our debate and bring an end to it. And you have already begun my thanks for me. And I'm also delighted and ask you to appreciate the contributions from Helen, Nessa, Robin, and Roger. Thank you all very much.